Okay, so today I want to once again delve into the journalistic abyss of Polygon and a recent article the publication has posted titled "Why I'm Not Buying the Harry Potter Game." Now, to be clear, simply not buying a game is nothing newsworthy. However, if there's an adequate reason to not buy that game, take your pick, there are hundreds in today's modern AAA space, then I and most others can easily support that decision. This headline from Polygon leaves pretty much everything open-ended, that is, if you ignore the subheading, but we'll get there in due time. Why won't they buy the game? What has Warner Brothers done? What does the game contain? Microtransactions? A higher initial price tag? Is there a copyright abuse problem? Who knows? This past year has been hectic, to say the very least, in the industry, but something in the back of my mind immediately said to me, no, 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 it's probably not based on the tangible. It is most likely based on the intangible, and this writer is extrapolating a position of anger based on something that is not directly related. Turns out I was right, but going further, it's not just an intangible position far removed from the game itself, it is a completely disconnected concept that, if adhered to ideologically, in terms of what we do and do not support or purchase, would mean the fundamental destruction of our ability to exist in the modern retail world. That's a really confusing way to put it, I understand, so let me explain. There is a rather funny show called The Good Place. It's quirky, but I mostly enjoyed it. It's pretty good. And for those who have not seen the show and care about a mild spoiler for one particular season, maybe skip the next minute or so of the video. Basically, The Good Place is about heaven and hell. The good place is heaven, and to get in, there's a point system that catalogs each and every decision that you have ever made during your lifetime. The problem is, the point system has remained unchanged since the dawn of time, and now, with the complexity and ever-expanding history of the world, the point system has run into problems. Easy example. It used to be true that eating a tomato would award or subtract exactly 0 points, but in a world of genetically modified foods, forced labor markets, corporate exploitation, and so many more factors, the simple action of eating a tomato takes on an obscenely negative point correlation. And over the course of a few years, and these far-reaching point calculations skewing negative because of 10,000 different reasons every single day, it ensures that no one ever even gets into the good place. Well, that's kind of what this writer is arguing for. In an abstract way, as we will soon read, this person genuinely believes that a personal opinion of the creators, almost 20 years removed from the initial concept, and not at all involved in the creation or development of this game in the slightest, should dictate what we, the customer, are morally comfortable buying. It's not unheard of, and it's entirely respectable for that position to be exclusively personal, but as we will read in just a minute, the broad strokes comparisons, insinuations, and connections drawn by this journalist basically suggest that buying the new Harry Potter game is tantamount to a hate crime. It's rather wordy, so I'll read a condensed and truncated section that adequately explains, without all the embellishment, exactly why the game is so bad. Quote, J.K. Rowling, the creator of Harry Potter, has proudly declared and displayed her transphobic views numerous times. Rowling has been criticized for these views in the past, so perhaps that's why Warner Brothers said in an FAQ about the game that she is not directly involved in Hogwarts Legacy. Harry Potter is Rowling's creation, however, so she stands to benefit financially from the game. Whether that's a one-time licensing fee that she's already pocketed or something linked to sales percentages, we don't know. But as Rowling is the owner and creator of Harry Potter, it is impossible for this game to exist without her agreement. There's also the possibility that the game would lead to a boost in sales of Harry Potter books and merchandise, which, again, would generate income for Rowling. Rowling is already incredibly rich, and the money that she makes from Harry Potter books or paraphernalia doesn't particularly bother me. Yeah, okay, that's why you bring it up so much. The issue is relevance. Anything that keeps Harry Potter relevant keeps her relevant. Rowling is not just a transphobe, she's the transphobe in chief, the respectable face of hate, the celebrity representative of transphobia. As the author of Harry Potter, she's one of the most well-known public figures in the world. Anything that keeps her in the press also keeps her transphobia in the press and leads to further distress for trans people. It's not just the money, but the influence that money buys, the stature that her fame and relevance generates, and the fact that her reach does more harm than her bank balance. End quote. That's basically the entire premise of the whole article. J.K. Rowling believes in the concept of biological sex, a position that can be seen as antagonistic by certain activists. Whether or not she is right or wrong, or how she goes about advertising her personal beliefs, is not the topic of discussion for today. But completely ignoring any sort of discussion in that particular philosophical arena, this is a writer, author, and original founder of a fantasy universe who has a personal belief that does not align with a specific activist agenda. Stacey Henley, and by extension, Polygon here, have put forward the claim that this game should not be bought because J.K. Rowling is accused of transphobia. There are repeated references to the financial benefits of the game for her, with a simultaneous claim that the author does not care about the financial rewards or her bank account, hard to take seriously with so much emphasis placed on it repeatedly, but even allowing for that concession here, the game is accused of keeping J.K. Rowling relevant, thereby keeping her transphobic opinions relevant, which in turn allegedly harms a subset of the population. Where do I even begin with this one? So, setting aside the fact that opinions are effectively only relevant as long as there is opposition to them, because the moment you say something there is no counter narrative to at all, it basically just dies out immediately, meaning that as long as the social media mob is screaming at her and about her, the opinions that she has will continue to be amplified, but as soon as they stop, her opinions will just fade away into the void, basically like me right now with this damn article, but that's a little too self-aware for right now. Setting all that aside, this argument is reminiscent of The Good Place because it totally misunderstands the complex reality of history and commercial creation, especially when that creation is a multinational media empire with thousands, probably tens of thousands of moving corporate parts. Let's use an example. Bayer Pharmaceuticals, a massive German pharmaceutical company that has existed for many decades, verifiably developed, tested, and perfected many of its most popular and most useful products in World War II concentration camps. This extended to birth control and other contraceptives, anti-inflammatory pills, and to go even deeper, the United States offered sanctuary to many Axis German scientists in the aftermath of the war for things like rocket fuel research or engine design. Trace this lineage now to the modern consumer level. The headache pills that you buy, same as Harry Potter legacies, might directly financially benefit someone, or especially the descendants of someone in this case, who held an ideological position that you hate. An ideological position so much worse than anything J.K. Rowling has ever or will ever say, but we all still buy those pills, and those contraceptives, and whatever else it is, because these issues exist in a way that is two, maybe three times removed from the actual product. J.K. Rowling created the Harry Potter universe. Yes, she might get some of the money from a game like this, and as obvious as it is that the author hates that fact, they are correct in their deflection that it is insignificant compared to what she already has, but the sale of a Harry Potter franchise game, developed by Warner Brothers, with no input from J.K. Rowling herself, is not so egregious as to keep her in the spotlight, thereby keeping her personal opinions on a stage that then harms the lives of random people she has never met. J.K. Rowling does not make policy, and she does not make legislative decisions. A likely counterpoint here is that I have criticized Disney recently for the movie Mulan and its support of concentration camps in China, but even then, with an entertainment company and a digital entertainment product, it still can't really hold up. Disney directly supported the administration of a labor camp, that administration being synonymous with the Chinese Communist Party, so that is a single-step process. Mulan from Disney supports an administration that makes policy and legislative decisions executing atrocities, one step removed. However, to really hammer home this point, it's important to circle back to something that like-minded activists will typically support: Planned Parenthood. Did you know that Planned Parenthood was started in New York during 1916? Did you also know that one of the founders, Margaret Sanger, believed in the concept of eugenics? Did you know that she spoke at eugenics conferences all through the 1920s about how to weed out the unfit and prevent the birth of defectives? And lastly, did you know that the German government before the Second World War borrowed much of their sterilization law and framework from the United States? Knowing this now, should Planned Parenthood be boycotted because it is associated with fascist ideals, because the concept, supported by its founder, allowed Germany to forcibly sterilize its people? Some would argue, yes, it deserves to be boycotted, but for entirely separate reasons. I find it hard to believe that anyone out there will trace that thread back through history and say, yes, boycott because of this tenuous connection, which in reality likely does not directly correlate in the slightest to what the organization is now. Harry Potter legacy sales support Warner Brothers, and maybe they give a small financial benefit of some kind to J.K. Rowling, but J.K. Rowling does not make policy or execute atrocities. The argument is that this game, by extension, somehow elevates her social media presence, and that social media presence causes harm to the trans community, placing them at risk. Not risk from her directly, risk from the actions of those that see and act on her post, somehow elevated by sales of this game, I guess, which never even called for action of any kind. And therefore, buying this Harry Potter game, somehow, because of all these things, is a bad thing. It all comes down to a sad but true reality. Terrible people, or worse yet, people you disagree with, oh the horror, I know, the travesty of it all, people you disagree with can still create things that are enjoyable or valuable to others. You do not echo or amplify the belief set of a person you hate who crafted a story 20 years ago just because a licensed third-party game based on that story or universe comes out 2 decades later and you decide, cool, I kind of want to play that. If that logic were to be replicated here, you could probably never buy or enjoy anything ever. America has swept a lot of things under the carpet. We're not perfect. Neither is the rest of the world, for that matter. But if you dig through the decades-long history of any major company, you are going to find people that either held or actively hold ideological positions you disagree with, and the financial performance of their company benefits them. Undeniably, it does. You are not siding with them in their personal social media postings just because you bought the diabetes medication that their company provides. And to think that that would even be remotely close to accurate is childish at best. In the end, Harry Potter Hogwarts Legacy is not going to elevate J.K. Rowling to some as of yet unattained position where her already completely public and well-documented opinions suddenly do more than they previously did. The sum total of which seems to be whipping up a storm of anger against her because they dislike what she said. The opinions of an author are just that, opinions, and they are not expanded and given more malicious power by purchasing a third-party franchise video game that got licensed and paid for years ago. Let's come back to the world of reality here. But that's it. If you want support, there's links down below. If you made it this far in the video, you are probably more interested in supporting, so I'll do the locals plug at the end for this one instead of the beginning. This video will be available ad-free in an audio podcast form on locals.com. YouTube makes routine changes to their AdSense policy and requirements. Relying on revenue from the AdSense program is a pretty stupid thing for me to do, and thus Locals is one of the numerous steps, more coming soon, that I'm currently taking to get away from that. For $5 a month, you get merch discounts, ad-free viewing of the uploads, audio podcast format, stuff like that, and direct access to me on messages and questions, which will always get a response on that platform. Link down below. There's also another gaming YouTuber to check out, but I'll cut it there and stop rambling. As always, thank you all for watching, and have a nice night.